Hello students, welcome to Chrome IS. Today we'll be doing the current affairs part of it. I just want to tell you that current affairs is a portion which is a very significant part of our pre as well as mains. In pre, the requirement is of the factual questions, the facts are required, and in the mains, in paper 2 and paper 3, analysis is required. And in paper 1 as well, a lot of current affairs is a requirement of the paper. Today, we are going to start with a topic which was there in the news recently. The topic was that recently Austrian government had decided to withdraw from the compact of migration. The Austrian government, Austria, wanted to go out of the compact of migration. Now, this was the news. Now, we need to understand that in this news, what is there for us? Because there will be many newses in the current affairs scenario. Our purpose is to make them paper worthy. How are we going to use them in different papers is what our aim is. So this is what I am going to tell you, that how you are going to use these nitty-gritty informations, these facts, while making your mains answer more in a better manner, you can frame them, and this is the way you are going to do it. So when we see this migration, first of all, we need to understand what migration is. Migration in itself, human migration, is a very important topic for our understanding. Migration. This is not a new phenomena. This had been there since very long. Migration is the movement of people from one place to other place, maybe temporarily, or important to know that it should be temporary, it can be temporary or it can be permanent. Because in general, when we think about migration, we have a tendency to think that it is only permanent. That is why it's very important to note this point, that it may be temporary as well. Second point, the cultural affiliations of the first place are left behind and of the new place are taken up. Then it's called migration. Now there may be a question that why this migration takes place. There may be different reasons for migration. The first and foremost reason can be economic. We all know that for jobs and all, today we see a lot of migration is taking place. Second migration we can see is socio-cultural. Under socio-cultural, we can take in terms of when a marriage of a woman takes place, she has to move from her parents' home to the home of the man. This is a scenario under socio-cultural migration. Third migration, reason for migration can be political. Political reasons as such, we can say, when the government wants to rehabilitate people from one place to other place, like we have seen in case of Tihri rehabilitation, when Tihri Dam was created, a lot of rehabilitation was done. Or in the case of Sardar Sarovar Dam, we have seen a lot of migration has been done. Or we can also see in terms of international scenario, when China deliberately adopted a policy to migrate people from the mainland China to Tibet in order to populate Tibet with Chinese population. So this was also a case of political migration, and there is a new reason for migration, and that is much more important now, and that is environmental migration. This is a very important point, environmental migration. This stream of migration is still very new, and the problem about this stream is that we are not properly talking about. There were news that when Syrian migration was taking place to Europe, one of the reasons behind that was also the famine which has taken place in Syria. Although main reasons were different, but a basic reason cannot be denied here to be environmental. And as we are seeing that the climate change is taking place, and in the near future, we have an expectancy of the temperature rising above 1.5 degree or 2 degree, then a lot of islands and low-lying areas will be submerged. Then a lot of people will start moving from those places to the places which are safer, and we'll be having lesser land to live. When there will be lesser land, then there will be problems. So environmental migration is going to be a big problem in the future, and this reason should be considered at present as a part of this migration process. Now, this is about human migration. There are few characteristics of this migration as well. We can see, if the distance of this is long, then the migration is less. So we can say migration is inversely proportional to the distance. Longer the distance, lesser the migration. We can also see in the characteristics of migration that migration's characteristics are changing rapidly. In the past, what used to happen was that the migration, primarily I'm talking about economic migration was taking place in the lower strata of the society. For example, I'll tell you, we have seen in many of the Indo-Pacific countries, in many of the countries like Mauritius, like Fiji, these countries are having people who have migrated to these places long before. And these people migrated to these places to work in tea plantations and different menial jobs, not high class jobs, not high technical class jobs. So in the past, what used to happen was the low class jobs were being seized, and for that long migration was seen from India to these places, this long distance migration was seen in this terms. But today what we are seeing is that long range migration is done by technical professionals, is done by educated individuals for teaching and all, for research and development. So here it becomes very clear that today long range migration is being taken up by people from the higher strata of the society. So this is the change which we have seen in terms of migration. Then few other characteristics which we can also see are that migration is more related to economic factors. The maximum amount of migration which takes place is because of economic factors, that is to get the jobs. This migration we can see in terms of domestic level as well as international level as well. This is the most dominating form of migration which we can see in long range migrations. But the problem is that in short range migration, we see the domination of socio-cultural migrations. Why? Because of the marriages taking place, a lot of women have to move from one village to three or four villages around that region. So it is a short range migration. The short range migration is dominated by socio-cultural migration, whereas more of the long range migration is dominated by economic migration. Then if we move to another characteristic, this is that big cities, if we see like Delhi, Mumbai, these big cities develop more of the reason of in-migration. Actually, if we take into account how a city increases its size, there may be natural reasons, What are the natural reasons? Natural reasons are the difference between birth rate and death rate. It will show us the increase of the number naturally. What natural increase is taking place in a city will be given by subtracting birth rate from the death rate, number of people getting the birth and number of people dying in that region. Now what will happen is that this factor is not such a big factor in the development of these cities, in increasing the size of these cities as such what is done by the migration. In migration minus the out migration, this is a much important factor today in increasing the size of the cities. Then few more characteristics what we can see is that migration primarily takes from rural areas to urban areas. Rural areas, actually in Indian terms if we talk about, migration should always take place because of the pull factors of the places. But in India, migration is taking place because of the push factors. Now, what this pull factor and push factor are? Pull factor is always about the attraction of that place. Why people used to move from rural areas to urban areas was because a lot of jobs were present in urban areas. Along with the quality of life is very good in urban areas. You have facilities of health, you have facilities of education. So this used to be the pull factor of the urban centers. And the push factors of rural area is the lack of facilities. Now if we talk particularly about Indian migration, Indian migration is showing a different tendency, that it is more governed by the push factor of the rural areas rather than being governed by the pull factor of the urban areas, and that is creating another problem for India. But here we need to understand that more of the migration is taking place or should take place from rural areas to urban areas. Then what are the impacts of this? A lot is dependent on what impact this migration is having. Although today, if we talk about the impacts, or if we think about the impacts of human migration, these impacts seem to be negative. Why? Because we are in an era where protectionism is increasing. We see that Trump is denying people to come to his country. We see that European Union is not happy when people from Syria are migrating to their places. So, in that terms, what we feel today is that migration is a negative concept. But no, migration is a very important aspect of human development. Why? I'll tell you, because it helps in redistribution of population. And that too meaningful redistribution of population. Now, what is this meaningful redistribution of population? Actually, the thing is that if we see, this is the word. Always in this world, the resources are not equally divided. There are some pockets of resources and then there are some pockets of scarcity. Now the thing is that if equal amount of population is living here as well as here, then the people living here will always live in scarcity and people living here will always live in abundance. So in order to balance this, what will happen is that people will start moving from this place to this place. From the place of scarcity to the place of abundance, if people start moving, it led to meaningful redistribution of population. So this is the first positive impact which we see, and this was the reason probably large amount of migrations had taken place in the historical past. When we see the people started moving from Africa, they moved to Asia, they moved to other regions, they started developing civilizations. It was because of the reason that the resources were less where they were living, and they expected that where the places where they'll go, there the resources will be in abundance. They'll be able to use those abundant resources. And the places where those abundant resources were available were the river valleys. So we have seen that the old civilizations developed in Indus Valley, in Huang Ho Valley, in Euphrates and Tigris. All these old civilizations developed along the river valleys because the resources were more. So those were the starting streams of migration which we can see in the past history. Then if we look into this, the modern phenomena of migration helps us in structural changes in the economy. Structural changes in the economy. Now what is this? If a country has to move from its agriculture base to an industrial base, then even if they don't want, or even if they want, then rural people should move to urban areas. That's the resultant when structural changes takes place, because rural economy is always dependent on agriculture, whereas urban economy is always dependent on industry. So if we have to move from primary sector to secondary sector, then anyhow we need to have a movement of people from rural area to urban area. Then only the required amount of people to work in the industry will be available. So this is the second point which we need to see as a positive impact of migration. Then there is another important point, that this human migration, what it helps in is redistribution of wealth as well. By this what I mean is that when a person will move from the area of scarcity to an area of abundance and that person will work there, then what will happen is that he will earn some money and pass on the remittances back to its own region. So now what is happening is that redistribution of wealth from this place is taking place. And that is how even underdeveloped regions, regions with less of the resources, can also be developed by this kind of a economy. Now, the best example of this is that a lot of Indian diaspora is living in the Middle East. They are working in the cash-rich oil industry. And what they do is that they are sending the remittances back to India. And that is how India is one of the highest remittance getter in the world at present. So this is also an important part of it. Next is that when the money will come better, the money flow will be better to the backward areas, the spending in the backward areas and the development of the backward areas will also be gradually improved. So all these impacts are the positive impacts of migration. So what we need to understand that in these era of protectionism, in this era of people going against globalization, we are talking about the era of deglobalization. Migration is having its importance, and the people should move from the areas of scarcity to the areas of abundance. Then only a balance in meaningful redistribution and balance in the population will be created around the world. Now we'll talk about how this migration can be seen. We can prepare a chart for ourselves. Migration can be of two types. First is voluntary migration, and second is involuntary migration. Voluntary migration, we know that when the people move with their own will, then it will be called voluntary migration. And involuntary migration will be a situation when people have to move from their home without their own consent. This kind of a situation arises when a person becomes a refugee or a asylum seeker. Refugee is a person who is moving because of the reason of civil disturbance or natural disaster. Civil disturbance or natural disasters are the reason because of which refugees move. We have seen in the world there are many refugee streams which we can see around the world. The best example today is Rohingya. Rohingya refugees are the refugees from Myanmar. And later we'll also discuss about this, that can they be considered under refugees, because government of India initially wanted them to put under the heading of economic migrants. Once we'll finish off with this whole chart, we'll understand that which person can be kept where. So Rohingyas can be seen, or Syrian refugees can be seen as an example. Whereas asylum seeker is a person who is undergoing a political persecution. Like Edward Snowden wanted, an asylum when he was being persecuted in his own country, when he gave the details about the snooping program by the US government. So he wanted a political asylum in the in different countries. So this is the case of asylum. But this is not important for us. What important is that side of the table. In that side, what we can see is that this voluntary type can also be divided into two portions. Voluntary type can be illegal, or second, it can be legal. If we talk about the people who are moving illegally, but where do we see these kind of tendencies? These kind of tendencies can be seen. First of all, I'll just digress from the topic. I'll tell you one thing in order to make you explain this. There is a global south and a global north in this world. This is a denotation taken up in order to make you understand that global south and global north. These terms are not concrete terms, but these are representative terms in order to make you understand, or in order to club countries into groups which are more recognizable. How will you recognize a global south? It will probably be a developing country or underdeveloped country. And if we talk about global north, it will probably be a developed country. Again, why we are calling it a global south? Because majority of this kind of countries are found in the geographical south. If we go below the equator, then majority, like we see all the countries in South America, then in Africa, then in Asia, Southeast Asia, the countries which are poor, which are developing, which are underdeveloped, are coming south of the equator. That is why it is considered to be global south. Maybe there are exceptions as well, like Australia is an exception to it. But then we are talking in general, it's not a particularistic kind of a definition. Whereas global north, if we see North America, Europe are primarily in the northern hemisphere, so we call them global north. So here we come back to our topic, that this illegal migration primarily takes place from global south to global north. This we can see when people move from Mexico to North America, to USA. So we can say Central America to North America or to USA, the migration, illegal migration which is taking place, which we are also seeing in the recent news, when Trump denies the entry of people from Mexico, where Trump, he promised to make a wall at the Mexico border. All these promises were coming out of this problem, that the illegal migration, the migration taking place from south, global south to global north, was illegal migration, illegal voluntary migration. And that is why the government has to become a bit strong against the people who are moving like that, because illegal migration should not be allowed. Second case we can also see is that global south to global south. And a good example for this will be people from Bangladesh moving to, again, these kind of people either come because of the push factors or come because of the pull factors. But ultimate thing is that they are coming to the country without the required certificates, without the required documents, and because of which these people are not liked by the host country where they come. Now we move to the second part of it, and that is the kind of migration which is taking place legally. Legal migration can take place in two ways. First, of permanent kind. A migration which is having a potential to become permanent. Potential to become permanent. Under this kind of a heading, we can see the migration which takes place is from global north to global north. For example, people from North America moving to Europe and vice versa, from Europe to North America. This kind of a migration can also be seen. Then one more strand of migration we can see is from global south to global north under this category. Now, where this kind of an example can be seen is from South American countries to Iberian Peninsula. If we look into the world map, we will see that Iberian Peninsula is a peninsula present at the tip of Europe, the western tip of Europe. This peninsula is having countries like Spain and Portugal. Now, Spain and Portugal were the countries who were the initiators of colonization. And whom did they colonize? They colonized the countries in South America. So today, the people who are present in South America are having their affinities, are having their connections with the people of Spain and Portugal. We should know this thing, that Portugal was having a control over Brazil and Spain was having a control over Argentina. So the people from Argentina, Brazil have a tendency to move to the Iberian Peninsula, and they are having a potential to become a permanent resident of that country. But there is another second form, and that is the most common. The most common form is that temporary migration. This is the most broad category, and we can see in terms of north to north also there is migration, although it is not very much. Global north to global north can also be seen, but it's not too high. More of the migration can be seen in terms of south to north, global south to global north. This we have seen for economic purposes and educational purposes. This is what, when I was talking about the migration which is taking place in the higher strata of the society. So economic and educational migration is the part of that only, and it takes place from country like India, where people are moving to US, UK, EU, Australia. So these are the countries where the people move from, countries like India. Yeah, we can generally say from South Asia. There can be another strand of movement, and that is global south to global south. Like we have in generally seen, people from South Asia moving to Middle East. This Middle East is also called West Asia. We know that if we make a world map, this is Africa, this is Saudi Arabia, this is India, here somewhere is North America, and this is South America. So if we see, this region is called West Asia, or this is also called Middle East. Now these two terms are also confusing. Why I wanted to tell you this, that this is called Middle East from the perspective of people living in the West, from the people living in Europe and people living in America. Whereas this is called West Asia from the perspective of people living in Asia, people living west to it, east to it, sorry. So from Asia, people call it West Asia, and from people who live in Europe and America, they call it Middle East. So this is a confusing term. In general, this is about the same area, but sometimes it's very confusing to understand. So the movement to these areas from South Asia is a global south to south movement. Primarily, this movement takes place because here oil is present and cash-rich economies have a lot of jobs for technical people from the countries of South Asia. So this is the whole chart which you should know about migration. And once you know this chart, then what is going to be very beneficial for you, that any news which now comes in the newspaper, now you will be able to know that a person will come under which category, the news will come under which category, the people who are moving will come under which category, and then you will be able to create an answer accordingly. So this is about the types of migration. Although in the future lectures, we will also be understanding few points about the refugees, different refugees, the movement of refugees that is taking place from few places. So, different places, different refugees are seen, and those topics need to be discussed separately. Rohingya crisis need to be discussed separately, like Syrian crisis need to be discussed separately. So, we are going to give a complete lecture for that. Here, what we will discuss further is that few organizations, few compact, from where I started the news, is the UN Global Compact on Migration. UN Global Compact on Migration, sorry, Compact on Migration. Now, what is this? There was no treaty as such for governing migration in the world. And I already told you that migration had been a very important part of human history. So, in 2016, the countries under UNGA came together and signed a UN compact. This is compact. Compact means an agreement. Under this, what they did was that they wanted to improve the governance on migration and address the challenges associated with migration. But few technical points initially we should know about it is that it is the first intergovernmental agreement on this. This is first intergovernmental agreement. Intergovernmental agreement on migration. Before this, there is no agreement on migration. Now, whenever you see any kind of agreement, any kind of body, the first question which should come to your mind is that, is India part of it? Or who else is a part of it? So, the answer to this is that India is not a part of this, whereas many of the countries which are very important countries like US, Hungary, then recently Austria moved out of this. So, this agreement is not doing great. But are these people moving out because of some reason? And the reason again is that the movement of people from one country to other is not seen today as a very good practice. It is seen as a threat to the host country, maybe to the culture of the host country, maybe to the resources of the host country, maybe to the jobs of the host country. But there are many reasons which are defining our deglobalization, our protectionist policies. So that is why countries are moving out of this agreement. But a very important point about this agreement is that it was not legally binding. Not legally binding. These kind of points are particularly asked upon by UPSC. They want to know that do you have this understanding that even when the people are moving, it was not legally binding. So, there was no as such legal sanctions against the country if they do not allow any kind of migration. But still, because it creates moral pressure on them, that is why the countries are moving out of it. Then there is another organization. This was an agreement which has taken place in order to understand the governance, in order to improve the governance of the whole of the migration, then address the challenges associated with today's migration, strengthen the contributions of migration. So, all this had to be done under this global compact, but then people today are moving out of it. So, it is showing a trend which is very much prevalent in the world. But next, when we move to an organization. The Global Organization for Migration is International Organization on Migration, IOM, International Organization on Migration. Now, whenever a organization will be there in your current affairs, it's your duty to know that when it was established, where the headquarter is, the reason for its establishment, and the fourth point is that, is India a part of it? These four things, at least if you know about the organization, then you can be very sure that most of the questions in pre regarding the organizations you can tackle. I cannot say 100% because today UPSC is going into other details as well. But at least for every organization, you should know about these basic aspects of it. So when we talk about IOM, it is an intergovernmental organization. Intergovernmental organization. The first point is this, that it is an organization which is working amongst the government itself. Second point, India is a member of it. India is a member of it. This is an important point to note, because if we move into the domain of refugees, we haven't signed UN refugee conventions. There are different reasons for that. I'll discuss those reasons as well. But just for information sake, we are not part of them. Its headquarter is in Geneva. Geneva is in Switzerland. Switzerland is a kind of a country which has always remained neutral, even though it is a part of Europe, when where World War I, World War II had been seen. But then also Switzerland had remained neutral, and that is why many of the organization's headquarters can be seen in Geneva. So this is to give you one tip, that whenever you don't know about the headquarters of an organization, then there are chances that it may be in Geneva. So for the sake of making guesses, you can use this also as a means to answer the questions. What are the points on which this organization works? Again, it works on migration and the development of migration, then facilitating migration among the countries, regulating migration, avoiding forced migration. These are the points. And this was established in 1951. So these are the points which you should first know. And then what else it is working upon is the domain you should also delve into. So this is about migration. But there was also a report in the domain, World Migration Report. Now, whenever you start an answer for your mains, it's very good to start with some data. Always, if you have a concrete data in your hand, it gives a good picture of your answer to the person whom you are trying to impress. That means here in the case, the examiner. That examiner understands you know the problem. Once you know the problem, then only you can solve the issue. So whenever there is a question, if you have a relevant data about it, it helps a lot in making the answer more relevant. So if there is a question regarding migration, then you can quote this report, World Migration Report. World Migration Report. This came in 2018, and according to this migration report, it is said that since 2010, global migration has increased by 10%. So it gives us a picture that global migration is increasing. Why global migration is increasing? We can give the examples out of those charts which we had made formerly. Maybe because of the economic reasons, the technical professionals are moving. Then maybe because of the environmental refugees which are moving to today. maybe because of the people who are moving for education's sake. So the global migration is increasing by 10%, and one out of every 30 people today is a migrant. Tell me one thing, that what is the population of this world? Today it is around 7.4 billion people. Today we have reached around 7.4 billion. These kind of generic details you should know so that you can throw up these in your answers, which is going to make your answers more credible. And these kind of things help you to make assessments also of various kind of questions. If I ask you what's the percentage of Indian population as compared to that of the world population, India is having 17% of the population, 17.5% of the population. And here starts all the problems of India, because we are having 2.4% of the land and 17.5% of the population of the world. Here is the starting of each and every problem in this country, of the resources, of the education, of the health, because we are having large amount of people, less amount of land, less amount of resources, and because of this we are facing all the kind of problems. So Indian problem is always the problem of population. But it will be too generic to write the Indian problem is the problem of population. If we can give this figure, 2.4% of land and 17.5% of the population, then the examiner will see that you know what you are talking about. So this is the fact which you should remember, these generic details you should remember. Indian population according to 2011 census was 1.21 billion. So this roughly comes to 17.5%. So this kind of figures also helps you to understand a larger picture, to be comparing these things. Like one figure is very important, that is the size of the economy, size of Indian economy. If we have to compare India and US, how will you compare? Comparing them on numbers is very easy. US today is almost 22 trillion economy, whereas India is around 2.5 trillion. You don't need to remember the exact figures, it's just the comparison you should know. This tells us that we are almost 1/10 of American economy. So how we can stand up against them in terms of militarily and other things if we are economically this small? This tells us the harsh realities. But for comparison, we should know at least these kind of figures. These are very important to know. Although we were talking about world migration report, let's come back to that topic. Let's not digress more about it. But this world population is important to note, because now we are going to talk about how many people are moving place, moving from which place to which place. Three point three percent of population of the world is migrant. Now you can calculate it by yourself. I already told you 7.4 billion people, and out of this 3.3% are migrants. One more important point which I initially told you or haven't cleared it yet is that 72% of the migration, 72, that is the bulk of the migration, is taking place in between the age group of 20 to 64. Now answer me this question, that 20 to 64, this age group is the age group of working. The people who are capable to work, these are not people who are dependent on others. And the migration is majority, is 72% is by these people. So the reason for migration will always be economic. So it's very simple to know. But if you write this figure along with your answer, then it will make it more credible. And one more important point, which will again prove that my chart was a very comprehensive one, is that almost 50% of the migration is from South Asia and Southeast Asia. Now we can see, we had always seen in that figure that from global south, maybe to global north, or maybe to global south itself, migration was primarily of these two kinds. So we can see that these two have been the host countries. We haven't yet seen where they are moving, but to make sure that they are moving primarily, 50% of the population of the migrants, that is of this 3.3%, are moving from South Asia, Southeast Asia, and China, because China is not the part of Southeast Asia. So this you should know, and you should also know, along with this, we can create a diagram . This will be source country. And this will be host country. Source country means the country from where the people are moving. And this is host country is the country to which the people are moving. Now tell me this thing. That if we look into the list of the source countries, which all countries will be seen in that list? Yes, primarily the global south countries will be a part of this list, and global north countries will be a part of this list. We'll see these countries at first. India. Here at least India is at the first position. Second is Mexico. Again, Mexico, remember, Mexico is the part of global south. Third is Russia. And the fourth is China. This is the list of host country, source countries from where the people are moving or the migration is taking place. Whereas if we see the list this side, first is US, second is Germany. Here, Germany. Germany is the country which gave permission to the people moving from Syria to come to its soil. It was one of the only few countries which were allowing this kind of a migration to take place, because of which even Angela Merkel had been facing a lot of UN cry in her own country. Because again, I had already told you that the protectionism is increasing in this world. The people are having more and more tendencies towards protectionism. Maybe they are feeling that their jobs are being robbed, their resources are being robbed. So Germany is the country which against the normal order, allowed the people to move to its own country, and that is why we see a lot of migration taking place in Germany. Third is Russia, and the fourth is Saudi Arabia. Now this Saudi Arabia is also an example of global south to south movement, when south to global south movement is taking place. So again, whatever was there in that chart can be seen superimposed on this information, and it can be compiled into a better info thing. Now, almost 46.6 million people are coming into USA. Now, we can see that even though Trump is denying that the amount of people to come to USA, but still, at the tune of 46.6 million people are coming to USA every year. So, USA is obviously going to have some problems. So, while we are going to write an answer on this, we cannot take only one view that USA is doing it wrong or Trump is doing it wrong. We should also understand that when USA talks about this, this is that a large amount of people are moving to USA. And yes, when large amount of people are going to move to their country, then some problems will also be created in their country. So these are the figures which we see. One more figure I just want to talk about here is that if we see India as the source country, how many people are moving out of India? India, I already told you, we are around 121 crore. In the 2001 census, we were 121 crore. Today, we are around 126, 127 crore. So, we are increasing very rapidly. Out of them, 1.5 crore are migrants, have moved out. Now, if we see, this kind of a population is not present even in many of the countries of Europe. This is the amount of people which are moving out of India. So it's in our benefit to be a part of the migration chain of the world, to create those organizations which are going to govern the migration in a better manner, because Indian diaspora around the world is of the tune of around 1.5 crore. And the maximum number of people moving from India are to UAE. This is not very shocking to know that UAE was the country where a lot of expatriates from India were living, and that is why when Kerala flood took place, it was rumored or it was said that UAE was ready to give a huge amount of money to Kerala government to rebuild, because maximum population of Indian migrants in UAE are from Kerala. So, second number is US, third is Saudi Arabia. So, these can also be asked in a pre-based question where they can say that which are the countries which are having the maximum destination of people along in the world where people have moved. So, US is the highest, then Germany, then Russia, then Saudi Arabia. So, this gives us a very complete picture about the migration, what has taken place around the world. And this is how you need to prepare a topic when you see our news about migration. So, you need to know all of these things in order to be ready for any kind of question in UPSC. My task will be to make you understand that a topic requires understanding. Maybe in the future, I will not be covering these topics in such basic details, but I will try to cover the whole of the topic along with the facts, so that you will get an understanding of the whole topic, and whenever a new news comes in for that topic, you will be able to cope up with that news, you will be able to understand that news. This will be my target.